what does a Bodhisattva ideal mean to me? So I'm very pleased and happy to have this opportunity to say a few words on this topic. Yes, what does the Bodhisattva ideal mean to me? So the interesting aspect that interests me most in that statement is the word Bodhisattva. You know, what is a Bodhisattva? So a Bodhisattva is somebody who's vowed to gain enlightenment for the sake of all beings. And what interests me in that statement is the phrase, for the sake of all beings. I find that just very, very intriguing. I can sort of get the idea of gaining liberation for my own peace of mind, my own sense of freedom. But I'm more deeply curious about how does one do this or walk this path for the sake of everybody, you know. You know, the deepest level, we're not separate from other creatures. So to live from that view would be so amazing. So for the sake of all beings, so I was thinking about this, and apparently there's something like 7 billion human beings on the planet, and of course billions and billions of other creatures as well. In the UK alone, there's 70 million people. So that's an awful lot of people. And, you know, I think in Tri Ratna, over our history, since the late 60s, we've been very, very good at setting up Buddhist centres. Got some amazing Buddhist centres running incredible programmes of Dharma, Dharma study, Dharma practice, friendship, sort of the whole life approach to the Dharma that we get in Tri Ratna. So I think what we've been really good at, certainly in the West, is creating conditions where people can come to us. So people who are ready or able will seek out a Buddhist centre, and then they'll get this situation of friendship, intensity, depth, and an opportunity to really go deep. However, the thing that I often reflect on is that we live in this particular age in the West. I'm talking mainly about the West here because that's what I'm familiar with. It's an age very dominated by a scientific worldview. So we believe what science tells us more than what faith traditions tell us. I'm generalising, obviously. But that's what all the stats show us, that we're becoming an increasingly anti-religious population. Fewer and fewer people going to church, for example. So that's interesting, isn't it? We've set up these Buddhist centres that are fantastic, kind of temples in the cities and the towns. People can come to us, but it requires people to, you know, seek us out, to find us, and then to have the courage to go over the threshold of a Buddhist centre, to walk through the doors of a Buddhist centre, which can be quite a difficult thing for many people. I know for myself that was quite scary at first. So, you know, when you think about it, just objectively, 70 million people in the UK, it's a tiny, tiny percentage of those people that will ever come to us, that will ever go over the threshold of a Buddhist centre. So what about all the other people? Are we interested in trying to help them as well? I'm sure we all are. But it's very intriguing, you know, how can we add to our model, so not only people coming to us, but also us going to the world. That's what I'm very inspired by, very curious about. How can we reach out into the world and reach the people that perhaps need the Dharma the most, but would never ever think of coming to a Buddhist centre? How can we somehow translate the Buddha Dharma into language that people can understand from all walks of life, whether they're educated, whether they're uneducated? I think Sangharakshita has done an amazing job in this area, but nonetheless, you know, I would guess it's a really, really tiny minority that ever read Sangharakshita's books, just because they don't come across them in our culture, in the culture that we live in. So yeah, how do we reach out to the world? How do we offer the Buddha Dharma to all the millions and millions of people, billions of people that are suffering unnecessarily in this world? And I say unnecessarily because my own observation, my own belief is that most of the suffering that we experience is well, the Buddha would call it the suffering of ignorance. You could translate that as a suffering of reactivity. So if something happens to us, we don't like it, we resist it, we fight against it, and we suffer even more. That is completely unnecessary. It's what you could call optional suffering. Such a simple message. And yet, so few people have heard this simple message. So, we've got these two models. One is the world comes to us, which I think we're very good at, and the other is we go to the world, which I think is an area that we could do better at. So for the sake of this talk, I'm going to call that socially engaged Buddhism. Probably not a perfect phrase, but for the sake of this talk, that's how I'm going to describe it. So one way that I've been interested in pursuing this is through an organisation called Breathworks, which I founded back in 2001. In Manchester, and we offer mindfulness to people with pain and illness mainly, and also people who are just stressed out with daily life. So we're offering an aspect of the Buddhist teachings to people who are suffering often very, very intensely through fighting and resisting difficulty, particularly if you have an illness or an accident, something comes upon you that ruins your life. And I find it deeply inspiring to offer mind training techniques, heart training techniques, lifestyle training techniques in order to ease that suffering, all drawn directly from the Buddhist teaching. And what's very rewarding and wonderful about this is it seems to work. It seems that the language which we found, the language we developed, seems to be acceptable to a lot of people. So that's also very interesting, isn't it? We have the Buddha Dharma come down through the centuries. When it goes to different cultures, it takes a different shape, shall we say. So how do we translate the Buddha Dharma in this modern, secular, scientific, anti-religious age? Very, very interesting question. And I think the whole mindfulness, what do you want to call it, the mindfulness movement in our society is an example where something's erupting into the culture that's working for people. The language seems to be language that people can understand. We've now got over 200 trainers, teachers in over 25 countries. So it's very, very, it's a lovely thing that in all these different places all over the world, people who are suffering with pain, illness and stress are having their suffering eased through the methods that we've developed drawn from the Dharma. And I think that this is very valuable for two reasons. This socially engaged Buddhism, where you sort of translate Buddhism into the language of the culture. I think this serves two purposes. One is it eases suffering. So that is just very, very immediately beneficial. That, there's all these people in the world and we've got so much suffering in the world. And some of that suffering is optional to do with our reactivity. So socially engaged Buddhism through things like Breathworks, it just eases suffering on its own level. Helps people live happier, healthier lives. You could say it's kind of, in the jargon, it's a well-being intervention. And I think there's huge value in that on its own level. And of course, it's not offering the full Buddhist path. I think it's important to be very clear about that as well. It's taking an aspect of Buddhism, translating it so people can suffer less. But of course, what the Buddha realized was something far more profound. You know, he realized complete liberation of heart and mind. Through profoundly changing his view and seeing into the nature of things, which is that everything's changing all the time and we suffer because we resist that natural flow of things. And that also applies to oneself and others and this whole idea that we're kind of static beings relating to each other. You know, I'm a static being, you're a static being, and then we have all the stuff that goes on in relation to that. Well, the Buddha says that's deluded, that there are no static beings. And it's just the arising and the passing of conditions flowing through. Of course, it's much more profound than that as well. But that's a different kind of doorway. So you have the doorway where you ease suffering on its own level, and then you have the doorway to the full liberation that the Buddha experienced and that he's passed down through, what has become passed down through the Buddhist tradition. And what I see again and again at Breathworks, which I find deeply rewarding, is a socially engaged project like Breathworks can offer a bridge to people then to discover the answer to their existential suffering through Buddhism, to this path of complete liberation, which is very, very complete. You've got ethics, you've got ritual, you've got faith, you've got friendship, you've got mind training, you've got heart training. So going back to my original point, where we've got these amazing Buddhist centres, we've got millions of people who are suffering. You know, how do we let the population know that these Buddhist centres are amazing places to go if you want to change your life, if you want to transform your life, if you want to free your life? You know, we've got the Buddhist centres, we've got the population. How do we get the population to want to come to the Buddhist centres? And I think things like Breathworks can be a really excellent bridge. So that's another one of my inspirations. We're going out into the world, we're easing suffering on its own level, and we are also creating a bridge so that more and more people can access the full magnificence of the path as taught by the Buddha. So that, hopefully in a fairly clear way, tells you what the Bodhisattva ideal means to me. Thank you.